From a biological perspective, swarming is one of the most amazing behaviors that honeybee colonies perform. But from a management perspective, swarming can be quite annoying. And so in this video, I'm going to talk a little bit about the biology of honeybee swarms, why colonies swarm. I'll talk a little bit about the timing of honeybee colony swarms, and then that will lead me into talking about why swarming is sometimes necessary to manage, especially if you're wanting to produce copious amounts of honey. So let's start from the biology perspective. When you look at a honeybee colony, it's very tempting to look at a colony as a collection of thousands of individual bees, each doing their own thing to make their own lives better. But in reality, when you look at the colony, it's most appropriate to look at the colony as if it itself was an organism. We have a term of this in entomology. It's called the superorganism concept. The idea here is the prefix super means above. So when we say superorganism, we're talking about a level of organization above the organism. The organism is the bee, the superorganism is the colony. So in order for this superorganism concept to hold true, then colonies must do what organisms do. What do organisms do? Organisms take in food, they mount immune responses, they have all of these types of things that you and I might do as organisms. Well, one of the things that organisms do is that they reproduce. So you can look at a honeybee colony and ask yourself, how do honeybee colonies reproduce? Well, they reproduce by this process that we call swarming. Swarming is not when you're being attacked by bees and bees are flying all around you. Swarming is when a superorganism, this social insect colony, tries to reproduce itself. So that simply means it's not a honeybee colony's goal in life to just become stronger and stronger and stronger. If they were, that's all you'd have to worry about as a beekeeper. They'd want to grow, you'd want to facilitate that, and you could maximize honey production, etc. Instead, it's a honeybee colony's goal to take one colony and make it two. They accomplish that process through swarming. So when a honeybee colony is ready to reproduce, you know that they will begin investing in new queens. The old queen and about half of the bees in that nest will fly away. When you are watching that process, when you are watching that colony swarm, you're essentially watching a colony give birth. It's colony level reproduction. So that swarm coming out of that hive is basically a baby bee colony being born from that nest. And of course, once it moves on, it goes on to find a new cavity into which it can move and establish a colony that itself, hopefully next year, will be able to swarm. But let's go back to the parent colony, that colony that just swarmed. It just lost its queen. It lost, you know, on average around half of its workers. It has to grow and develop a new queen. That new queen has to emerge, has to mate, has to start laying eggs before that colony begins to rebound in population. So biologically, fascinating. The behaviors associated with swarming, remarkable. But it causes your colony to lose a queen. It causes your colony to lose bees. It causes your colony to have a period where it's not producing brood. Because when that colony swarms, they have to replace the queen. That can take a couple of weeks. That queen has to mate. That can take a couple of weeks, and when she lays her first eggs, it can take 21 days before those first eggs go through all the developmental stages and you have workers emerging. So when your colony swarms, you lose 6, 7, 8 weeks of brood production. So why can swarming be a problem for beekeepers? Well, it's not the biology. It's not the amazing behaviors in which they're engaged while they're issuing this swarm. Instead, it's all about timing. Think about what I just said. That cluster with the old queen has left the colony. It's sitting in this cluster on a tree limb, on a fence post, sending scout bees off in every direction, looking for a new cavity, and when they find that cavity, they move into it. Once they move into it, they use the incoming resources to build comb, to store honey, to raise brood, all before fall and winter arrive. So because of that, it benefits colonies to swarm in the few weeks leading up to the major nectar flow or during the major nectar flow. Bees need incoming resources in order to maximize the likelihood that that cluster that just left your hive is going to survive winter. That means the vast majority of colonies are going to time their swarm season to those weeks leading up to the major nectar flow or throughout the major nectar flow. From a beekeeping perspective, that means your colonies are most likely to swarm, to split, when you least need that to happen. They're splitting right before you need your colonies to be as strong as possible to take advantage of the incoming nectar to make all of this honey. So beekeepers find oftentimes that swarm management is necessary to keep those bees in the nest at a time of the year that you can't afford to lose those bees. Another thing in line with that is when your colony loses its queen. Remember, 6 to 8 weeks of brood production that you can lose. And if that happens in the weeks leading up to the major nectar flow or during the major nectar flow, all of that lost brood production, all of those lost bees, the lost queen, can absolutely destroy that colony's chances of producing honey this season. So while it's amazing, while it's beautiful, while it's poetic, while it's biologically fascinating, it can cause a problem from a management perspective. So what do you do about swarms? Well, fortunately, beekeepers have been dealing with this issue since beekeepers have been interacting with honeybees. But I will say something on the front end before I talk briefly about swarm management. Swarming is colony reproduction. That makes it by default one of the strongest drives that honeybee colonies have. That means when you're trying to control swarming, you are trying to stop one of the key biological processes that that colony finds itself wanting to do. In fact, they will work very hard against what you're doing. So I hesitate to use the words swarm control, but prefer instead to use the words swarm management, because you're doing everything you can to stop it, but occasionally colonies will slip through and swarm in the process. So if you think about swarm management then, swarm management is about addressing all of the issues that lead colonies to swarm in the first place. So what are some of the stimuli that lead colonies to swarm? Well, lengthening daylight, warming temperatures, right? Coming out of winter, going into spring. The presence of drones. Queens start producing drones because it takes drones to be available in the environment to mate with those new queens being produced in colonies after the swarm. Congestion, these growing colonies in a limited amount of space. All of these available incoming resources because of all the flowers blooming as the result of lengthening days and warming days. The age of a queen, the older the queen, the more likely she is to swarm. All of these stimuli are what ultimately push colonies over the edge and cause them to swarm. You can tell that swarm season is imminent when you start seeing the production of queen cells in your nest, usually in early spring, because the bees are trying to produce queens before they swarm with their old queen. So swarm management then is about addressing all of those stimuli you can control. You can't control lengthening days, you can't control warming days, but you can control the age of the queen, the space in the nest, the presence of queen cells. So some of the most basic strategies related to swarm control include keeping young queens in the nest. Queens that are a year or younger. Remember, when colonies want to swarm, they will swarm with older queens. They can swarm with virgin queens. They can swarm with young queens. But keeping a young queen, maybe requeening early in spring to get ahead of that queen age issue. If congestion is an issue, you can add supers to ensure that there's enough space in the nest for that colony as it's growing to store the resources that are coming in. Another way to deal with space is split colonies. If you think about it, making a split is essentially causing that colony to swarm in a very controlled fashion. You are the stimulus leading that colony to swarm, and rather than that swarm landing up into the top of the tree, you've moved that split straight into a nuc or another hive body. You've created the swarm. You've solved the problem. You've removed that stimulus. Equalizing colonies is another good technique to use to reduce that swarm tendency in the nest. What do I mean by that? That simply means going to those weaker colonies and taking bees and brood from stronger colonies and moving it into those weaker colonies and making it where all the colonies in your apiary are on the same level playing field. What that does is it increases the population in your weaker colonies as you move into that honey flow season, but it reduces the population of those strong, booming colonies that are ready to swarm. You can equalize colonies a number of ways, moving bees and brood. You can switch places between strong and weak colonies. In the middle of the day when a lot of foragers are out, you put a weak colony in a strong colony's place, a strong colony in a weak colony's place, and the foragers return and boost the population of the weak colony and weaken the population of the strong colony. Another thing that you can do to reduce the swarm tendency in honeybee colonies is remove the queen cells in those nests every 7 to 10 days. If the production of capped, so ripe queen cells, is that last stimulus that leads a colony to swarm, then staying ahead of that will reduce that swarming tendency. Again, I suggest every 7 to 10 days. If you wait longer than that, the colony will try to swarm. If you go in more frequently than that, then you're not giving them enough time to make those cells and you're wasting everybody's time. But if you're going to commit to that, you really need to do it at least once a week to ensure that you're staying ahead. Assuming you've done all of those things, the last thing that I recommend is clipping your queens. Now, clipping your queen is not really swarm control, it's more swarm insurance. If it's the existing reigning matriarch in the nest that leaves the hive with the swarm, then she's the one who shouldn't be able to fly if you want to keep that swarm there. So what I would recommend in this context is keeping all of your queens clipped as just a standard management practice. Find that queen. Queens have two wings on both sides of their body. Their front wing is the larger of those two wings. It's called the forewing. If you tease it away from the body and clip half of that wing off, the queen will be unable to fly. The wing will not grow back. It causes no damage to the queen, and it's a really good swarm insurance mechanism. Even if they try to swarm, she'll go up in the air, fall on the ground, the bees will cluster around her, she'll go back in the nest. She might try it again, but she'll never be successful. You won't lose the bees in this context, but if the colony tries to swarm multiple times with a queen who can't fly, they might try to replace her in the process. So you could still end up with a queenless colony if they're trying to swarm with her and can't do it, but you will at least keep the bees and you can solve the queen problem another way. My last bit of advice with swarm management: no single one of these techniques will be sufficient. Commercial beekeepers will often spend a lot of time splitting colonies in advance of swarm season, but really it's going to take multiple techniques to collectively reduce this swarm tendency. So for example, for me, in a typical hobbyist or sideline operation, I'd clip my queens, add space when necessary, so super as appropriately, and remove queen cells every 7 to 10 days. Those are three things that I've done, three things that our lab staff does to stay ahead of that swarming tendency. But keep in mind, even the best management decisions can fail to stop a colony from swarming when the colony is set on doing it. So these are just a few tricks of the trade to reduce that tendency, but it won't eliminate it in all circumstances. But the key is, for every colony that you can stop from swarming, you will produce more honey or have more bees and brood available for splits or pollination later. So swarm management is really good if you want to keep not just healthy colonies, but productive colonies.